just want to thank you for being here with us today, Al. Thank you for everything you do for our church. Thank you for the amazing things you do in our community. But most importantly, thank you for leaking for Christ. So here you go. Thank you.
It's always an honor to be here. And I do love you folks, and I love all that this ministry is and stands for. We're going to be looking at Hebrews today, the book of Hebrews. Going to be looking at a few verses. The Epistle to the Hebrews is one of the most important books in the entire New Testament. And it contains some of the most important doctrines of Christianity. And I made this statement last service. We can only release the benefit of God's rule and authority over us and His power flowing through us to the degree that His rule is, in fact, over us. I was reading my father-in-law's message from back in 1953, and right away when I said that in the last service, I knew that I was in trouble because, as Matt said, Sean equates me with all those people that we read about in Hebrews. And so already he's going to have some ammo. And what he doesn't think of, Adam Kemp is going to think of, wherever in the world he's at. And I come here Sunday mornings when I can, and I am humbled, take an element of abuse, and then I go on. But that keeps me humble, I guess. Hebrews is a fascinating book. My father-in-law was an evangelist, and he published a sermon in 1953, and it went into a Christian paper that is circulated. At that time, it was circulated on the East Coast and portions of the Midwest. And he referred to Hebrews as the greatest description of Jesus Christ. And that chapter 1 is called by many the greatest in the entire Word of God. The Son is pictured, Jesus, as being above angels. His eternality is mentioned. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. His loftiness is described in creation. In the beginning, He laid the foundations of the world, and the heavens are the work of His hands. Beginning with the opening verses of the second chapter, our writer reaches a climax. And he says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip or run away from us, fall through our hands, opportunities, things that we should be doing. We let things slip when we're not in this book like we need to be. Often I carry this little New Testament, I'm about worn it out. And I use this to share the gospel with people and share things with them. We let things slip when our lives are not based on the Word of God. Many years ago, actually when I was a teen, my mom was the spiritual leader in the family at the time. And one day a young man came into our awareness and he needed a place to stay and a home to live in, and I don't know, his family was totally out of it, and he didn't have a place to stay, and she said, okay, you can stay under one condition, and she laid some rules down. We worked on it. We lived on a farm, and she said, you know, if you will fulfill these responsibilities, just like the rest of the boys, you're up in the morning, you do things, you work in a farm, you do hay, you'll always have a roof over your head, a warm meal, and a place to stay. Well, one day I had to go into Olean, and take care of some business. And I drove the family car, and he went along with me. And we got into Olean, and he says, "Well, Al, I got to go see somebody." I says, "You do?" "Yeah, I've got to go." I says, "All right, you be right here in an hour." I says, "I got things to do. I got to get back. I'll be right here in an hour." I came back, and he never showed. I waited and waited, and he never showed. He ran away. He tried to return, but under the conditions and the understandings that were laid out to him, he let things slip away. He burned the bridge. The things that he was responsible for, they slipped away. He wavered. There is a danger that I am so sad to say, in that I see the things material and otherwise get in the way of things spiritual, and opportunities that God would have for us often slip away. Hebrews 10, verses 23 and 24 tells us to hold firm the profession of our faith without wavering. I mentioned earlier, Dave, our senior pastor at Southside Chapel, Dave Hearn, you know him, was in Malawi. And he was with Enoch Dimma, and he met Enoch Dimma's father, who was a godly man, saved out of the cult that they were involved in there at that time. But they started several hundreds of churches. And he sat down and told the story, how that soldiers came into their community one day, rebel soldiers, and they were kind of playing around with little five-year-old Enoch Dimma and being somewhat abusive and laughing. And then he looks up. The soldiers looked up to Morris. Said, "Morris, are you a pastor?" And he says, "Yes, I am. Come with me." And they took him away. Enoch's mother then scooped up the kids and they fled for the border because she knew there was not going to be a good picture. And not expecting ever to see her husband again. Morris was then joined with five other pastors, of which they were abusive. They beat him around. They roughed him up. And then one by one, they made him come forward and stand. And they said, "Deny Christ and you can go free." The first three pastors did deny Christ. They came to Morris. "Morris, deny Christ and we'll let you go." And he says, "I cannot. I can't. I don't know what's going to happen. If I die, I die. I can't deny Christ." They pushed him off to the side. And the next two pastors then also said, "We cannot deny Christ." The soldiers then said, "You guys, you that will not deny Christ, get out of here." And they turned to the three that denied Christ. They said, "If you won't deny Christ, if you weren't willing to give your life for him, you are apparently false prophets." And they continued to rough them up. The three marched and they left. They walked a great distance. They didn't look back. In that culture, if you look back, they would shoot you. They felt the crosshairs on their back, as it were, and they walked. And when he got a tremendous distance, Morris said he kind of looked back and they were leading the other three away. And as they went off out of sight, then they heard shots, gunshots. Never saw those men again. Hold firm the profession of our faith without wavering. Oh, listen, folks, we don't know how lucky we are. Some of the ridiculous prayer requests. Pray for me. When I'm at work, they laugh at me when I pray over my lunch. Pray for me. And there are people in parts of this world that are laying their life down for Christ. Hold firm the profession of your faith without wavering. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and the good works. Only one other time in the New Testament is the word provoke used. And it is used in a negative sense in Acts 15:39. I know we've all read the story and we heard about Paul and Silas and the contention and how that was so great over John Mark that they went separate ways. It was so sharp that they departed. This is one of the reasons why I believe that Paul wrote Hebrews, considering the kind of man that Paul was, the tenacity of this man, the boldness, the unrelenting determination that he had. It's just like him to take that word and turn it around and use it for something good. We should consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. And incidentally, we see in 2 Timothy 4:11 that Paul turned to love toward John Mark several years later when he was imprisoned. He loved John Mark. Provoke unto love. You know, it's often easy to stir up anger, but it takes more to stir up genuine love and good works. That's why the writer uses this intensity, to provoke unto love, to create a desire in others to have what you have. Be contagious through the power and the Spirit of God. Several years ago, my phone rang, and I was a considerable distance from the destination that they had asked. They said, "Al, would you please go to Lou's bedside? Urgently, please, please hurry. And quickly go to his bedside. He's dying and his family is very upset. And he's, you know, he's heard the gospel. They've almost given up, but they just believe that God might save him at the last moment. Would you please go talk to Lou? He doesn't want anything to do with anybody that wants to witness to him." And after I arrived, and after the usual introductory words, he did seem to shut me down. He didn't want to hear it. And I said to Lou, I said, "Lou, your family's worried about you. Lou, eternity is around the corner. You're not ready. It's time to sit up like a man and face reality." And I thought to myself, "Al, what are you doing? You're just going to drive him away." And I came around the other side of the bed and I says, "Lou, won't you accept Christ?" He extended his hand with tears and prayed and asked Jesus into his heart. And within 12 hours, the man was gone, dead, in heaven. His son later said to me on the phone, "Al, my dad said to me, Mike, it's okay. I'm ready now. I'm ready to go. I feel a whole lot better about things." Micah, the prophet, the minor prophet, once said, "By God's Spirit, I am full of power to declare transgression and sin." So what does it mean to be provoked unto love? And I remember many years ago, I witnessed a mother hugging and loving and crying and kissing her little child the same time she was giving that child a spanking of its life, because the child ran out into traffic and narrowly escaped with its life, because mother snatched that child, endangering her own life, but brought that child back to safety. That's being provoked unto love. People are dying out there without Christ. You know, if you've got what people need, they'll find you. They'll find you. Just the other day, it was kind of a hard day Friday. We were tired. And Phyllis says, "You know, Al, let's go down and go somewhere and get a fish fry. Where do you want to go?" And so I'm thinking of all the little corner, little diners and places, you know, where there's not a lot of people. Shame on me. And she says, "Let's go to Sprague's." And so I didn't let her know, but inside I was saying, "Oh, Friday nights at Sprague's." And I knew it was going to happen. We got in the store, and before I got out of there, I've got 3 home visits I got to make. People were stopping me, talking to me. The lady that sat us, she was getting frustrated because I couldn't even walk through the restaurant. people would stop me and want to talk. Hey, you haven't been to my house. I'm hurt. Where have you been? Elderly people, people that are not well. If you've got what people need, they'll find you. So what does it mean to be provoked unto love? That being the case. In John chapter 5, 39, Jesus was trying to convince his own people, and he said, "Search the scriptures, and you'll see that I'm who I am, and still you won't be saved." And yet we read in Luke 13 and verse 34, where Jesus was weeping over Jerusalem. "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I would gather you as a hen gathers her chickens, but you won't receive me, you won't come." That's being provoked unto love. That same annoying fly was here last service. And I'm going to get him if... Matt, do something about it. Being provoked unto love. I don't love that fly. Consider once again the minor prophet, Micah. The elders of the land quoted the words of Micah unto love to save the life of the prophet Jeremiah. Did you ever, anyone ever know that? They quoted Micah to save the life of Jeremiah at the hands of those that were ready to kill him, being provoked unto love. The apostle Paul provoked the governor of Judah, Festus, in Acts 26. The Bible says that Festus was so annoyed, he said with a loud voice, "Paul, you're beside yourself, you're mad." And as a result, ended up under the King Agrippa's judgment, resulting in King Agrippa saying, "Paul, almost you persuade me to be a Christian." Boy, if you're here today and you're not a Christian, don't be an almoster. Be an altogether. All that being said, wisely, the writer of Hebrews did not leave his final application under the end of the book, but he repeatedly drove home this lesson in two little words, "let us." Let us. Notice now, six times that little phrase, "let us," appears in the scriptures. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, he's talking about leaving the milk of the word and going after the beef and the steak of the word of God, digging into it, not just stopping with the little things, with one or two or three verses, but studying the whole book, studying the whole chapter, digging into the word for the meat and the beef of the word of God. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection. Translation, let us be moved along. Morality will never be attained by personal effort as much as by surrender to God alone, who can accomplish the need of perfection in our lives. God's call never comes at a convenient time. It never comes at a convenient time. It involves surrender, laying down, putting aside things that you may think are important. I never try to pass up opportunities. I try to. It's not easy. I'm not going to lie to you. Today, early this morning, I read the names on the hospital. And I saw a name and I thought, boy, I know this person. And whenever I see somebody I know, I feel compelled to go. And so I went up. And it was not who I thought it was. I didn't even know the guy. But those are the good ones. But as it turned out, we talked quite a little bit, and he wants me to come back. Now, you wouldn't guess. You wouldn't believe. He's a Catholic priest from down Franklinville way. And as we were talking, he says, now, where are you from? You know, and I says, I'm from Southside, and today I'm going to be preaching at Believer's Chapel. I've heard about those people. Hey, that's good stuff. Never, ever underestimate the power of your influence and all there is about you. Never underestimate that. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us move on to perfection. God's call never comes at a convenient time. I know I told the story, and I'm trying to hurry along. a young teen several years ago came to me and said, Pastor Al, will you please go with me to my grandmother's grave, fresh grave? She just passed away. Would you please go there? And I said, sure. It was an autumn day, cold, rain. I mean, it was horrible. And I went. And we stood and got soaked over his grandmother's grave, and I just was with him, and it was important to him, and we prayed, and I took him home. To this day, a grown man with kids of his own, if he sees me, he almost runs to see me. Nothing astronomical, nothing catastrophic. It just meant something to that person. Folks, it is so easy to mean something to people around you. Never underestimate the power of your testimony, your witness. Let us go on to perfection. Some weeks ago, two ladies met me at the hospital. I was there for another reason. I was quite tired, and I was asked to be there, and so I went, and these ladies met me, and they said, Al, my brother, he's up on the third floor. And I've been here since 7 o'clock this morning. It was about 8 o'clock. He's never awakened. And I says, well, I'll go by. I'll go by and see him. But now tell me, what's his spiritual condition? Oh, he's not saved. We've tried. Matter of fact, when he was admitted to the hospital, he said he demanded to be put on there, no religion. You ever get to no religions? Those are the good kind. You ever get to no religion? And so I said, well, look, I'll go by. I said, you know, quite often family is not always effective with family loved ones who are unsaved. But an outsider sometimes has an in. So I'll go by. Well, he was out of it, right? So I walked in the room. I said, can he open his eyes? Yes. Miracle number one. And I began to talk to Ken. And I said, and you know, sometimes you got to say it the way it is. I says, Ken, I got right to the rubber meets the road. I said, Ken, if they carry you out of here feet first, where are you going to spend eternity? And I had him, and I don't need to tell you the rest of the story. He accepted the Lord, and he was the guy that when he received Christ, when he would pray the prayer that I led him, he was holding my hand. I'd say, now pray this prayer, but understand, you're talking to God, not to me. I'm just the messenger. And the prayer goes like this. Dear Lord Jesus, he'd squeeze my hand like this guy over here with a big hand, a strong hand. What's your name? I'm sorry I met you, your husband. Fred, just like you, when he squeezed my hand. And he would squeeze my hand. And I would say, dear Lord Jesus, I know you love me. I know you love me. And we went through the whole prayer. I knew that was a genuine salvation. No religion? Nope, no religion, but he's in heaven. He's going to go to heaven. Hebrews 12:1. The writer gives us, I'm running ahead of myself, 11:46. Okay, we got some time. He tells us to let us draw near. Hebrews 10:19-22. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest of the blood, by the blood of Jesus Christ, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us draw near. Like our praise and worship time, that is a time when we draw near to God and we become susceptible to the scriptures. We draw near. Translated, you are allowed to personally come into the presence of God the Father because of the finished work of Jesus Christ. And then he says in verse 24, and 23 and 24, we already looked at these. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith. And then he says, let us consider one another to provoke unto love. Your very countenance ought to be a stirring, inspiring, contagious countenance. And then in Hebrews 12, 1, our writer gives us our fifth and our sixth let us. He says, wherefore seeing also we are compassed about by so great a cloud of witnesses. Some people believe, many people believe, many Bible scholars believe that we are observed from those that have gone before us. We know if we read the book of Revelation that they were under the throne praying that their blood would be avenged upon the earth. So we know that there's a great cloud of witnesses. I don't know if my niece is here today, who I dearly love, but I'm telling you, Allison, that we are compassed by a great cloud of witnesses, of which in that cloud of witnesses is your Father, who you never knew, who's gone on before you, but he sees you and he's proud of you. And the day is going to come when you can put your arms around your daddy that you never knew. He's so proud of you. We're compassed by a great cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight and every sin which so easily distracts us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. As a young boy on the farm, I had obviously many jobs, but one of them was to take care of our cattle, and they ran in an open range area. And my dad used to always warn me, he says, now look at whatever you do, always keep one eye on the old herd bull. Don't turn your back on it, just be careful. Be careful. Okay, well, one day he had an attitude problem. And he went into a rage, and he snorted, and he bellered. I don't know if you ever heard of, seen a bull when they're tearing the dirt up and bellering. It's scary. And I was carrying 2 5-gallon buckets of water to the steers that we had in a penned-in area. And don't you think that I threw aside every weight that hindered me, and I ran, and I did not run with patience, but with diligence to get out of his path. Now, it would have been kind of foolish for me to run carrying all that weight. We run around in our lives and we carry weights. If the Spirit of God wants to work through you effectively and there's something going on here, it's hindered. So the Bible says, it tells us to lay aside every weight and sin that easily besets us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. To remove anything that would hinder one's effectiveness for service and cause missed opportunities. And I have to tell you, I'm not pure and white as a driven snow. I've looked back and seen where I've missed opportunities, and it really troubles me. Several weeks ago, I was at the hospital and I saw a name, and I thought, well, I don't think I'm going to go up and see him, because, first of all, I thought they aren't a member of our church, and I really need to be focusing on our people, and besides, I needed to hurry, and so forth. But something said, no, you go up there. That was the Spirit of God. And I said, okay, I'm going to go up. I walked in the room through the door, and the gentleman's wife said, see? She said to her husband, see, I told you Al Bat would be here. And what if I hadn't have gone? That would have been a missed opportunity. I come that close. Well, therefore we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest any time we should let them slip. We need to consider each other, to provoke each other unto love. I talked about provoking. I'll close with this story. Many, many, many years ago, Once again, I was in a hospital setting and I see some people in a waiting area. And I recognized them and I walked up. I said, you know, is everything all right? You know, is there something I can do? Oh, it's my dad. It's my dad. He's in such and such a room. And he began to describe a little bit about the situation. I said, would you like me to go see him? Maybe talk with him, pray with him. And he, well, he's probably not going to know you, Al, because of the condition that he's in. He probably won't know you. But if you go and you begin to talk, maybe his mind will open up. I says, okay, I will. And there was lots of family. So I went down into his room and there wasn't a single person, no family member in there. And right away, I liked the one-on-one. And I began to talk and he immediately, his mind openly cleared. And we began to talk. And he began to, when I started talking to him about the love of Jesus and knowing for sure that he could go to heaven, he began to cry. He began to weep. And I reached out. I said, Bob, take my hand. He took my hand. And immediately I felt that his hand was incomplete. Something was missing. Immediately I recalled the story as a young boy, how that he and his brother had a falling out. They both worked in a meat shop. They cut meat, and they were provoked. The contention was so great that somehow, some way, which I do not know, he cut a finger off. I don't know which one, or a part of the hand. And he never, ever forgave his brother. Now, that day I was in the hospital, his brother had passed away. And as I held that incomplete hand, I knew the whole story. I began to tell him about the forgiving love of Jesus. He never had a chance. He and his brother never forgave. And he quickly accepted the Lord right there. He prayed with crying, sobbing, praying, and received Christ into his heart. And as I left his room that day, over and over and over again, crying, he said, thank you, thank you, thank you, as if a tremendous burden had been lifted from all of those years. Because he and his brother were provoked to anger, but it turned to the love of Jesus. And Bob's in heaven today. And I'm sorry to say I can't say for his brother, who I also witnessed to years before that account. Folks, consider one another to be provoked unto love. Continue to do what you're doing with each other in your fellowship and such, but also let that spill over. Ask God to lead someone to you that isn't saved. Ask him for that opportunity to win someone to Christ, to know what it means and the excitement to receive, to show someone. Ministry takes place when divine resources meet human needs through loving channels to the glory of God. Divine resources, that's the Holy Spirit of God who descends into you and makes that supernatural difference. Channels, loving channels, that's you folks. Your channels, never underestimate. But make sure it's to the glory of God. Make sure he gets the glory. Hebrews says, how shall we escape? Hebrews chapter 5, verse 3, I believe it is. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by our Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? If you're here today and you haven't received Christ, how are you going to escape if you neglect it? You can. When you step across that threshold, you're going to go in one of two places. Are you saved? If you're saved, understand you can make a difference in so many lives. The power of the Spirit of God upon you, you would not believe the miracles that He can do through your life. I've seen them. I've been there. Lord, thank You for this time today. Thank You for Your word. Thank You for Your people. Thank You for their attentiveness. God, I pray that every single solitary person in this place will leave with something today. Lord, Samuel prayed, God forbid that I would sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for Your people and showing them the way. God, I pray that today they've been showed something that they'll take with them and that they'll never be the same. In Jesus' name.